Netto, Farah, sold the idea of checking out GraphQL under lunch. This talk is entitled Fighting Legacy Codebases with GraphQL.
All right. Thank you, Aaron, for the 5 minutes. So I guess I could use those extra 5 minutes now. So thanks everybody for coming here to see me talk. I'm really excited to share the story of the past couple of years working at IFT. And I have to say, I'm so excited to be here. I went on a journey, like a 14-hour flight, waited at the airport for another 8 hours, got here, stubbed my toe. I've been eating so much rice and pork, and I'm so excited about that. It's great to be here. Okay, so for the ones who don't know me, I'm Netto. You can find me on Twitter at Netto Farah. I was born in Brazil, but I currently live in the United States working at startups. So I guess the first part in here is take this with a grain of salt, especially because conference speakers are professional enthusiasts. So GraphQL is not a silver bullet. This is just my experience using it. But I encourage everybody to go ahead and try it after the conference and give it a try, see if you like it, see if it fits your needs. Okay, so a little bit of context. So when I submitted this talk, I used to work at this company, IFTTT. I don't know if everybody's familiar with it. But it stands for If This Then That, and it's this website and mobile app that allows you to connect different services on the internet. So you can create tiny little apps that automate things in your life. So one example that I created is thing called an applet for me. And it's every time I take a photo on Instagram, here in Bohol, I'll have it backed up to my Dropbox. So I encourage everybody to go and check it out, ifttt.com. So this is a story about maybe my last year and a half working at IFT. And for a little bit of context, IFT is an app with millions of users. So at the time that I joined, it was about like 10 million users. I don't know how many users are today, but then because it connects all of these services, we're also dealing with billions of API requests every day. So it's very challenging on the scalability side of things. And we had to maintain a website and two mobile apps. And most of this, especially the website and the integrations, were all coded in this seasoned Rails 3 code base. So it's a 7-year-old code base that, even though it has great code, it's not been aging really well. It hadn't been aging really well. But we had this technical challenge that we got some news that we're going to have to build an entirely new website and mobile apps. There are going to be some changes. We're going to change the UI drastically. We're going to have to add a bunch of new features. We were just 5 engineers working on the 2 mobile apps and the website. I was the only person doing full stack development, doing the front end and back end of this new website, and we only had 9 months. So we knew we needed to make some changes. Something was going to have to change about that situation, or we were never going to be able to finish that project. And there's an entire other talk that I could give about improving legacy Rails code bases, and there's an entire discussion about a majestic monolith versus microservices. And I think there's pros and cons to both of those, but it's not always that you're going to have the opportunity to work on a majestic monolith. It would require that you have been cherishing that code base, and it would require a lot of discipline for you to even get to the majestic monolith 7 years later. And then there's also the whole discussion on microservices and the complexity that they add and everything. So it's not really a binary decision. I believe because there's pros and cons, I guess we can pick and choose the things that we like about both of them, and we can try something different, and that's kind of what we did. So we decided to go with a hybrid approach and try and change our architecture in a way that we could have a rich API, but we could also build specific clients. And that's kind of the story that it follows now. So okay, we knew we needed to build an API. We decided to go with a hybrid approach, build an API that this new clients are going to be able to use, and some specific services we're going to use too. And it's awesome that Rails makes it so easy to build APIs, and it's great because our community is used to that. We're used to just create, it's so cheap and easy to go and create a new controller and another JSON. It's amazing how fast and how easy it is. But you start to run into some challenges with this sort of traditional APIs that we built. And one of these challenges, a very common challenge, is that you end up having multiple use cases for your API, and you end up having clients that have different access patterns. So what happens in here is that my iOS app might have some very different requirements when they access that API compared to my website. In some cases, in my iOS app, I might have to download a bunch of data up front so it can work on more unreliable network connections, as opposed to on the web, where you have this assumption that you're always connected, so you can always pull a little bit of data at a time, whereas in mobile devices, you might have to pull a lot of data when you know for sure that you have a good and stable connection. So you end up with this challenge now that when you start to design your API, you have to worry about, well, do I make my API very granular and add a bunch of endpoints and keep making all of those calls, or do I make my controllers and API a lot heavier now, include a lot of data, and try and cater to all my clients at once with just one endpoint. So one example of this is that I was reading this blog post about when SoundCloud moved to microservice architecture, and they were coding their new front end, and they ran into the situation that just to render a track on a page, they had to make 38 HTTP calls in JavaScript. So that doesn't sound very productive. So you can solve a lot, I mean, you can solve some of those problems, but another challenge that comes in is documentation and conventions. So it's hard to keep things documented, and some people even see documentation as duplication. So it requires a lot of discipline in here for you to keep your API and your documentation up to date, and what you end up doing is that you start relying on conventions. So, but conventions have a problem too. Here's an example of a convention. So that is the universal sign for OK in a lot of countries. And I know that because we went scuba diving two days ago, and the instructors kept telling us that we had to do this every time it was just to say the word OK. Except that if you grow up in Brazil, or if you ever visit Brazil, it has a very different name. And I should not say it here, so if you're curious, just come talk to me and I'm going to tell you what it means in Brazil. But yeah, do not do that there. So, okay, we know that we have all these challenges, we discussed all of those things, we knew we were going to have, we knew we needed an API, but some of us were a little tired of the way we kept building APIs in the past. So, GraphQL had just been open sourced at that time. There was a lot of buzz around it, and we decided to give it a try. Like do a swipe and see what sort of thing that we could do with GraphQL. And so, yeah, here's a definition of GraphQL. GraphQL being a language specification for defining and inferring APIs. But what does this actually mean? We could maybe be a little more concrete here. So one thing that's one of my favorite things about GraphQL, and one nice way to explain it, is that you can describe your data with types. So here's an example of how you can describe some data with types. So if I'm defining this API for the RubyGems website, I can start with a type called RubyGem, and that has a few call name, it's a string, it has a few downloads, an integer, and it has a few call versions, that is just an array of the version type. So what's interesting about this is that I can start to make certain guarantees about the shape of my data. I can start to reduce a little bit of the ambiguity of exploring APIs, and I can reduce a little bit of the need for conventions because I have my types now. And in a way, it's kind of self-documented too, because I'm just giving types to everything. Another thing, my second favorite thing about GraphQL APIs is that you can load just what you need. So here's another example of how to load data with GraphQL. So a query is like the most basic construct of a GraphQL API. I can go in, I can make queries, and I can choose a few that I want to query, a few in my graph, and then I can make selections in that few. So RubyGems is my endpoint here in the traditional API world, and I'm loading the name and the downloads for all my Ruby jobs. And you can even load multiple entities at once. So with GraphQL, I'm able to batch those two endpoint requests into just one query. So I can load my Ruby gems with their name and downloads, and I can load the current user with a login and an email. And what's nice about that is that I get predictable results. Because I have that contract that's the combination of a type and a query, I know that I always get the same result. So I got my Ruby gem here, I got Rails with 89 million downloads, and I got the current user, the local user that's logged in, and they're logging in their email. So one thing that's really cool and interesting about this is that GraphQL puts a lot of emphasis and focuses on the clients. So the clients dictate what they want from the data based on that contract that's established in the GraphQL API. So let's talk some Ruby. Let's see how GraphQL and Ruby connect. So I prepared a little demo here that I can share how to implement some of those some of that code that I just showed in the GraphQL language. So yeah, we can start just an example here. We can assume that this is our data model. So we're building the Ruby gems API, and we know what a Ruby gem is. We know that a Ruby gem has many versions, and we know that a version has many dependencies. So okay, our active record models in there has many from Ruby gem to version, and then from version to dependency. And I have two basic use cases for this API that I'm trying to build. I want to list all the available Ruby gems, and I want to search for a specific Ruby gem by name. So let's look at some code together. Can I get the pedestal? Just the microphone. So yeah, you can follow it if you want on this bit.ly, and you can check it out later.
Well, don't expect an array here, it's an authorless separated by comma.
And the same thing in number, the version number for that specific version, the dependencies again, another array of dependencies. And there's also this really cool and interesting notation that I can use now to create more complex lookups in my views. So my version also has downloads that's an integer, and I can just, but because it didn't necessarily map directly to the property that I had in my model, now I can just use the lambda to just define what the downloads count as. So if we keep scrolling down here, you see that we have the dependency, that's the same thing, the dependency has a name, has some requirements. And down here, this is how we define our endpoints. So I have the few Ruby gems that is that thing that we wanted to do. We want to list all our available Ruby gems. And again, it returns an array of Ruby gem type, and it has a description, it has a string. And here's the lambda that we can use. So because we're using Active Record, all I have to do is the Ruby gem all. And I'm customizing it a little bit. I'm telling Active Record to order them by name. And I could do anything that I wanted, any custom logic that I wanted in here. I could check if the user's logged in. I can check if there's like special permissions and things like that. And the same thing if I scroll down here, I can look them up by name. So that was the other use case that we had, that we wanted to search the Ruby gem by name. So if I'm just creating this view of my graph, I'm calling it by name. And I'm returning the Ruby gem type, give it a nice description. It takes in an argument, and I'm saying the argument is a string. I have this menu here before the type, and that just means that it's a required view. It means that the client cannot skip this view when they're making the request. And if I scroll down here, same thing again. I'm looking up my argument, and then I'm using RubyGem by name, that name. So to make things even more interesting, I wasn't expecting this to be so. To be so okay, so let's take a look at our API. So I have GraphQL running here, so I forked the RubyGems.org website, and I'm trying to build a new version of their APIs using GraphQL. So again, remember that we had that query being the most basic component of GraphQL, right? So I'm going to start typing here. And this tool here is part of the GraphQL ecosystem. It's called GraphQL, and it's nothing more than just a user interface to store GraphQL queries. I spend a lot of my time just taking a look at how my GraphQL, testing my GraphQL endpoints and testing my types and everything. So what's really nice about this is because I have types now, and there's a little bit of ceremony declaring my types, but I start to read the results right here. So whoever is exploring my API, they're going to start seeing all that documentation that I put together for them. So I can see in here that I can use the RubyGems view, and it returns an array of the RubyGem type, and it loads a collection of all available RubyGems. This is awesome. So if I hit enter and I start typing again, I'll see that I can do something like this. Boom, RubyGem gives a collection of all the RubyGems that I have my local database sorted by name. This is really awesome. So let's say that I'm building this website and I also want to get all the number of downloads for all of those Ruby gems. I want to create this nice little website with tiles showing the gem name and how many downloads. All I have to do is issue that request again. And I'm going to have to ask you to imagine some numbers in there, but because this is my local database, I don't have any actual downloads for those Ruby gems. But this is really, really cool. And remember the part that I said that you can just keep, the client just chooses what they want to see and they can keep getting more data. So I can keep exploring my API here now. I can see that I have this view called versions, and it's an array. It returns an array with the type version, and it's all versions that were published with this Ruby gem. This is awesome. Let's just try and load that. So I'm going to hit control enter again. It brings up the prompt. So I'm going to choose the number of the version. I guess that kind of makes sense. So boom, I get it right away here. I have action table 501, 502 in my database. This is really awesome. And I can just keep exploring this and seeing what else is out there. So let's see. I want to see who the authors are. So boom, for tick and DHH for action table. man, I could just keep going. If my client needs that, I can start to get all the dependencies for actually table, and I'll get their names, and I'll get what the requirements are. And I know the requirement for a dependency is just a version branch because it says in here my API. So if I hit enter again. Alright, I got all of that again. I know the action table depends on the action back and the version 5.0.1. It depends on NIO4R 1.2. This is really cool. So remember that we had another use case, right? The other use case was looking at the regen by name. So I'm just gonna start typing here by name. And you see the prompt just dropped that name property right away. And if I try to make this request, I just get an error right away because my query does not compile. I could, because it depends on types, and it gets analyzed when I send the query, I get the error message right away. It says, well, an object has to pass selection. Okay, so I'm gonna add a selection here, and I'm just gonna get the name. But it's still complaining. It says, the field by name is missing the required name. Okay, so I can do that. Go in here, and I can start typing the name, and I'm gonna search for Rex. Let's see what I get back. So okay, I got Rex back. I'm gonna comment out the second part so it looks a little bit faster. And I can get the number of downloads, 0, to that OS. I can go to versions again, and I can get the authors, I'll see that it's all the HH. Takes all the credit for Rails. But cool. Here's all the cool stuff that you can do with GraphQL. This is like a very short and like simple explanation, but I encourage everybody to go check out. There's a lot of really cool things that you can do. You can do PubSub, you can do streaming, you can do mutations, so you can't just like, it's just not query for data. Okay, so I have to change my display back again. Yeah, we just saw some code. And if you're curious about the code, all you have to do is go check out this bit.ly link. I posted it as a gist. So this is basically what we did. We built a GraphQL API on top of our data model. So at the end of the day, what we had now is a GraphQL API that acts as an integration layer for multiple not-so-microservices and front-ends. So now we have a rich API that caters to all those needs that we have. So we don't care now anymore if you're loading it from iOS or if you're loading it from the web, or if you're even like another service that we extracted out of the monolith and turned into a different service. But what's really cool about this is that we can use the monolith for what it's good. The monolith still holds all the data, it still owns all the data, and everything is coded in there, and because we expose so much of that data in this GraphQL API, we rarely have to make any changes to the monolith anymore. So you just basically swept the problem under the rug. And so here's how our simplified version of our current architecture would be edited. But this is software, so of course this is not accurate. It's actually a little more like this. The moment you put services in the mix, we start to get the curves, we start to get the explosion, things go down, things get super slow. But the internet is not as reliable as we think it is. So this is how things look like right now. We have a client on like that end, we have the internet, we have an API gateway that we use just to do some like cross-cutting concerns about our API, and then we still have our monolith with the GraphQL API. And we can keep extracting services now if we need, and we don't need to worry about how we extract those services anymore. If we should just like collocate the data with the service, if we should create new data stores for them, if we should break them by transaction or anything, because we don't care about that too much anymore because we have data as a service now. We're using GraphQL. So yeah, running GraphQL in production. So you can see that I'm very excited about this topic and that I really like these things, but it's not, of course, GraphQL also comes with its challenges, and we were kind of early adopters for GraphQL and Ruby, so we had to solve a lot of problems that came with using it in production. So the first thing that I was talking to some people about, and that's the first thing that I noticed too, is that what happened to our semantic status code? Because remember that I just showed everybody that you could do two queries in one, that you could fetch by name and loading all Ruby gems at once. So now I actually have two transactions or two queries going on in the same HTTP request. So should I invalidate both of them if there's an error? Or if I give it, if I give the client a 404 or 401, how would they know which one of the resources failed? And is it fair with both resources to just, or the 10 resources that I'm trying to access, should I just cancel all the entire thing? So, but again, it's not as bad as it sounds because we have types again. So you can have error types that come back in a request. So it's one thing that you have to get used to. So if your clients are heavily dependent on HTTP status codes, that might become a challenge. The other problem is N plus one queries. So that's one thing that happens to every Rails code base. I cannot think of a Rails code base that I've worked on that didn't have N plus one problems. And this happens in this case because you don't know the data up front, so you can't make any assumptions and just preload and eager load whatever thing that you want, because your API now is a little, even though it's strict with types, it's a little more loose now because the data that you fetch is so much more dynamic. But that can be solved too. So the way that we solve this thing is that because GraphQL is a formal language, it has an abstract syntax tree. So if you look at GraphQL query, it's actually a tree. So in each one of those resources, those fields that you try to access, those are trees. So, and because it kind of mirrors our data model, we can look at that AST, pull a hash representation of the data that you're trying to load, and feed that into Active Record preloader right away. So the more your GraphQL query matches your Active Record models, the better this nice little jam that I wrote will do. So in that case, we're loading all Ruby gems with all the versions, and because the query looks like exactly like the hash that I would like to feed into Active Record, I could just feed that hash into it, and Active Record will try its best to minimize the number of queries that I have to make. Another problem is monitoring any errors, because with GraphQL, all you have is one endpoint now. So you have this one endpoint that you keep accessing to get all of these generic fields. So if you're using something like New Relic, instead of having 200 transactions, now you have one transaction. That's all you got. So there's not much value in that if you can't have any visibility into what you're doing. So we had to implement instrumentation too. So we did it too. So it worked out. You can see that this is not a transaction table in New Relic. And I can see that you see like the fourth row down there is like statements controller. That's like a regular API call, like a regular Rails controller. But everything else that's coming from the GraphQL controller can also be reported that way. And you can still get all the nice things that you get with your monitoring tools, like some chart and errors too. And the same thing happened here. Instead of reporting just one exception, we can actually start to tell whoever's using a New Relic or any other error tracking tool can see exactly which one of the fields broke. So there's this nice feature in the GraphQL Ruby gem that's called an instrumenter, and what it allows you to do, again, because there's types and there's a query that's coming in, you can hook into the execution engine for the GraphQL gem and just report, get metadata of the types that you're accessing at the time and report that to your RBAC. So that one wasn't super hard compared to solving the N plus one problem, so I published it as a gist. You can just look it up if you're curious about monitoring the New Relic and GraphQL. So where to go next from here? I definitely recommend checking out GraphQL.org. They'll have a much better explanation and introduction than the one I just gave you. Check out the GraphQL Slack group, graphql.slack.com. There's a Ruby room in there, and I hang out there, and there's lots of great people there. The author of the Ruby gem hangs out there too all the time. He's like super responsive. He even implements like feature requests the same day. He's doing it full time now. He, you know, He left his previous job and now he's just doing GraphQL development full time. And yeah, check out the gem too, the link on GitHub. And that's it. Thank you. Grab me later for questions too. Send me an email or a tweet. No problem.
Hi. One question. Have you applied the GraphQL to APIs that you expose to third parties? Because one thing I'm wondering about is if you do that, how do you handle authorization where you would try to limit certain fields from being accessed by depending on the client that's accessing the data? How would you approach that?
Sure. So that's a great question. So at IFT, my previous company, we didn't expose it publicly, but GitHub does that. So GitHub has a GraphQL API that they have with their they can look up repositories, commits, and like a lot of really nice things. And the way to go about that, there's two ways that you can go about it. So you can implement middlewares in the GraphQL Ruby gem the same way that you can have before and after actions in Rails. So you can check for things. You can write a middleware that just goes through every one of the fields of the graph that you try to access. That's one way. Another thing that I find to be even more interesting that I think really cool is that there's this concept of credits that you can give your API clients. So you saw that I had that endpoint that just loaded all the Ruby gems in my database. And that's potentially problematic. We should not do that in production. But what we can do is that we can say, well, this operation has a complexity level, and we can give it a complexity level of 10, versus looking at the current user is just so cheap, we can give it a complexity level of 1. So what you can do is that you can give your clients some, I like to call it tokens. So if I give my iOS app 100 tokens, that means that they can load up to maybe 85 gems, and they can get the current user, and they can get a little more information. And then you can have GraphQL at runtime just let the client know that you're not rate limiting them, but you're limiting them from the access that they can have in the API. One question? All right.
That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.